Hey everyone, welcome to another edition of Power Core Productions and Podcastings. I am your host, Jerron Harrington, back to hit you with another video. And today, we are going to be continuing Fire Force Lightspeed Rescue, based on the Heroes of the Morphin Grid series, Part 1. If you haven't already, then please don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, share, and hit that bell for post notifications so you can stay up to date on everything that is Power Core Productions and Podcastings that has to come out now and in the future. Last week, we started with the part zero of this series, a way to give you an introduction into where the story was going to start and everything that was going to be happening going forward. This portion of the Fire Force story picks up after the events of episode 18 of season 1. And in today's story, we are going to be covering the events of the Netherworld arc, in which Fire Force Company 8 engages with the White Clad for the first time within the depths of the Nether. We will also be seeing Sho as he makes his appearance as well, meeting with his brother Shinra for the first time, the Red Lightspeed Ranger. Will the powers make a difference in this battle? And what will the future of this world be? What was the cataclysm that happened over 200 years ago? And how will the Rangers play an effect for the great day of fire that is to come? For all this and more, stay tuned as we continue today's story. So as always, sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. As Company 8 began their journey into the Nether, Captain Obi would try to keep the team together to avoid them being split up. However, the White Clad would already be making their move, as a thick fog would roll in among them, the team being tricked by illusions and other deceptions. And before long, they would find themselves split up and moved into different directions. Sister Iris would be with Tamaki, well, two Tamakis, with one of them proving to be an imposter. It wouldn't take long to figure out who the real one was, as only the real Tamaki would have a morpher. But there was also Tamaki's unlucky lecture, a strange phenomenon in which, by chance, in the words of Murphy's Law, what can go wrong will go wrong. Or in Tamaki's case, what can go lewd will go lewd. And out of nowhere, her clothes would usually fly off. In doing so, Iris was able to tell that that was the real Tamaki, as she helped her get her clothes back on. Once doing so, they would be confronted by a member of the White Clad known as Assault, a third-gen pyrokinetic with the ability to create flame that turned into various forms of missiles, from large to small, and even the small ones being referred to as flame bullets. Tamaki would morph into the Pink Lightspeed Ranger. Using her third-gen abilities, she would gain the Flame Neko ability, and using her special weapon, the Flame Claws, she would be able to slash through and attack the missiles, being able to deflect and dodge them with much more speed and precision. Assault being unable to get a single shot off on her, as she would go in for her close strikes, fighting with her cat-like speed and reflexes, being able to counter and hit him with a barrage of combos. She would go in to finish him off, and this would prove to be his undoing, as even in her ranger form, her unlucky lecture would take hold once again, and Assault would accidentally grope Tamaki in multiple areas, with his hand seemingly going up her skirt. That proved to be a fatal mistake, as Tamaki and Iris, both enraged, would begin to beat him to a pulp. And with Tamaki's enhanced ranger strength, the beating would be much more worse, as they left him in a bloody pulp and mess, as the two would make their way deeper into the nether. Meanwhile, Maki would also be making her way through. With Spire and Flare by her side, she would illuminate the cave area until she was confronted by a legion of white-clad foot soldiers, and the one leading them known as Flail, a large, muscular being who used his flame to create a wrecking mace at the end of a chain, and he could increase it in size. Maki would morph into the yellow Lightspeed Ranger, using Spire and Flare to activate her twin iron owls. The two flying metal machines would begin to move through and take out the weaker foot soldiers, while Maki would engage with Flail. He would create his mace to be three times her size, bringing it down upon her to try to smash her into the ground. However, Maki was always known for her already ridiculous strength, and as the Rangers would soon learn, their special abilities, tapping into the morphing grid, enhanced them in ways that they would never imagine. And for the White Clad, this would potentially prove to be their undoing, as Maki would be able to match Flail in strength, being able to repel his attack and deliver devastating hits of her own, countering before eventually beating him into submission, and before long making her way deeper into the nether. In the meantime, Lieutenant Hinowa would also be making his way through an empty subway tunnel, when arrow flames would shoot towards his direction. He would realize he were fighting with a long-range fighter, and in doing so, he would morph into the Green Lightspeed Ranger, summoning his assault pack. Looking to his back, in his array and arsenal of weapons, he would pull out a powerful sniper rifle and would make his distance. Unlike his regular sniper rifles, the one with an especially long barrel that had to be replaced every time he used it, the power rifle was far different from before. With no need to have to replace the barrel, he could get off quick shots as much as he needed. In doing so, going up against the white-clad member known only as Arrow, the two of them would engage in a long-range shootout. However, despite it being long-range, their attacks packed quite a punch. This wasn't a battle between an arrowist and a sniper. It was a battle between two actual living tanks. Arrow attempted to move Hinowa into a proper position, believing that if she could get him in close range, she could take him out with multiple flame arrows. As they battled, she would remark that for Hinowa, it was pointless to resist, that the White Clad would gain what they were looking for, and that they would not be stopped from their destiny. However, Lieutenant Hinowa would continue the fight, noting that as a member of Company 8, he would not go down so easily. And as he moved in closer, Arrow, believing she had done what she had acquired to do, as she created multiple arrows at almost point-blank range to take him out, she would be gravely mistaken as the smoke would clear, and Hinowa would be standing before her. Some marks and some scuffs on his ranger suit, but he was still completely intact as he pointed a large bazooka at her chest. As he blasted at point-blank range, it would create a large explosion, sending the two of them flying, knocking her out cold and knocking him into the back of a pillar. As he tried to regain his consciousness, standing before him would be Shimmer and Mirage, the two waiting for their prone opportunity to strike. However, what they didn't expect was that another ranger was lurking in the shadows. It was Arthur Boyle, the blue Lightspeed Ranger. With his plasma blade in hand, he would easily send the enemy retreating. Mirage would leave the fight to Shimmer, as Shimmer would create multiple illusions of himself. Arthur would remember his training with Company 7, remembering that only to strike when an attack had the breath of life, to not be fooled by the illusions before him. Even with his visor, Arthur would close his eyes and would stand steady, Shimmer having no way of knowing if Arthur could really tell if his illusions were fake or not, or if he was just waiting by chance, merely using dumb luck. Shimmer decided to wait in the shadows with his blade, as his multiple illusions would continue to attack onward, holding his breath and waiting for the right time to strike. However, Arthur was not fooled, and he did not move from his position. Arthur, a man of nobility, and someone who always believed in his righteousness, would stand fast in his conviction. Not a single twitch would occur from him. Once all of the illusions had seemingly faded, Shimmer would take only a shallow breath, but that breath, the breath of life, would prove to be his undoing. As Arthur would strike at the column that Captain Hinowa had slammed himself against, the captain wondered if Arthur had lost his mind, but that was far from the case, as from the back of the column, Shimmer would fall. Arthur would then move over to the lieutenant, helping him up, as the two rangers made their way forward to meet with the others. In time, Captain Obi and Vulcan would also be intercepted by the enemy as well, Dr. Giovanni and Lisa. Lisa was surprised that Vulcan had come here, and even more so that he was wearing the uniform of a Fire Force soldier, as she knew very well that Vulcan had always been against joining the Fire Force. However, Vulcan remarked that he wasn't here for that, he had come here for her. Dr. Giovanni continued to manipulate Lisa, using his years of brainwashing and manipulation and torment to trigger her and force her to fight on his behalf. Captain Obi would step forward and morph into the Titanium Ranger, this catching Dr. Giovanni off guard. The doctor, while he tried to taunt them with his knowledge that they knew they were searching for, the secrets of human combustion and of infernals, the reasons of why the White Claw existed. The doctor also had his own questions. He remembered the stories, that of the ancient times, when the great being Diabolico battled against these very forces. But it couldn't have been possible. Had Vulcan really been hiding this power all along? A power that the White Claw should have feared as greatly as anything? The one power truly capable of countering them in their goals? And even worse, if they all had it, then it meant the one that they were after, Shinra Kusakabe, could potentially go from being the White Claw's salvation to being their undoing. All the same, the doctor would command Lisa to fight, as she used her lava tentacles to try to bind and subdue him. However, it proved to be useless, as the power of the Titanium Ranger, increasing Captain Obi's already ridiculous strength despite not having any firepower of his own as a first generation pyrokinetic, the captain would fight smartly in his battle. Carrying his titanium shield, he would move from tentacle to tentacle, almost seeming as though he were on the defensive, but that would prove to be not the case, as he had actually placed extinguisher grenades on each one, having them all go off at the same time. They would all disperse immediately, and Lisa would be saved by Vulcan. As she cried out for help, Vulcan would hold on to the girl that he had come to know and love, as they looked back to Dr. Giovanni, who attempted to strike at the two of them. However, despite not being a ranger himself, Vulcan did have some useful tools, as he put on the penguin helmet, morphing from out of his trench coat. He would smash into Dr. Giovanni, knocking him back, as Captain Obi led the charge. He would take his power axe and morph it into the power blaster, shooting away at Dr. Giovanni as the mechanical monster would morph weapons from under his cloak as the two engage in a one-on-one fight. Dr. Giovanni quickly realized that the captain had the upper hand and that these rangers could prove to be more trouble than they were worth. As he disappeared into the shadows, he told them that the time would come in which the next great flame would emerge into this world, and just like the ones that preceded them, they would be unable to stop their master and their ambitions. As he had already known that Shinra was already on his way towards Captain Sho, the outcome they had wanted from the beginning. Captain Obi tried to gain more information, hoping that he could gain as much as he could within the battle. However, the Mad Doctor would disappear, and before long everyone would gather together again. Now knowing what they needed to do, they had to make their way towards Shinra, as Shinra went off to engage with his brother. As for Shinra, along with Lit, they would make their way into the deepest parts of the Nether, as Shinra would come into a great hall. They would see among the many columns in the center of the large room, a boy with white hair and with eyes like that of Shinra's, looking upon them, sitting on a throne. He was in the traditional garb of the white clad, his sword by his side. As Shinra walked forward towards him, an overwhelming sense of relief, as he had finally come to see his brother. As Shinra made his way towards him though, Sho would make it very clear where he stood on things. He would ask him why he had come, and why he referred to him as brother. Shinra remarking that they came from the same mother, and that they were a family. However, Sho would scoff at this notion, remarking that he would never come from the same filthy womb as him. And as he said those words, he would quickly backhand Shinra with the back of his blade, knocking him into a wall. However, Shinra would quickly rise to his feet and appear in front of Sho once again. However, as the light hit upon his face, there was no smile, but his face was cold and expressionless, with just a seething anger at those very words that had been spoken. He warned Sho to never say such things about Mother, but Sho would not listen to him, stating that even if they were family, that was in the past, and now he was nothing but a target. With those words, Shinra would look to his morpher. As he clicked on the device, an instant glow of red would illuminate the room, as the red Lightspeed Ranger engaged with the captain of the White Clad. The two would move at immense speeds, Sho and Shinra beginning their fight. However, it became very clear who had the upper hand, as it seemed as though no matter how fast Shinra moved, Sho was just always faster, appearing where he wasn't originally. As they continued on in their fight, Sho would tell Shinra that they were from two different universes, remarking that they were not on the same level. Shinra didn't understand what he meant by this, and Lit, as he watched from the background, would slowly piece together Sho's very words. In an attempt to display the difference in their powers, Sho would create an Adola link with the two, and they would arrive in a white empty void filled only with black fame, as the ash and bone would burn all around them, the black fire emanating from that of a being known as the Evangelist. Sho would remark that this was his power, where Adola bursts got their strength. It was from the dimension known as Adola, or as others would refer to, as Hell itself. Sho would explain that it was with the grace that he was given by the Evangelist, the one that watched over him, that allowed him the power to do what he did, and he would put it on full display. Lit would realize that Sho's very ability was cooling the universe from his flame, slowing down time, and thus allowing him to move in his own space within their reality. Sho would remark that Shinra simply could not move fast enough, and that whenever he chose to stop time, he was the master of his universe. As he mocked Shinra, beating him over and over again, stabbing him in the arm, his strength strong enough to pierce through the suit, Shinra would go to create distance, remembering his promise and knowing that he could not fail in bringing his brother back. In doing so, Shinra would activate his special ability, the Red Soles, or the Devil's Boots, and his white boots would transform into a crimson red that would set aflame. This was his power. His feet were his weapons. As the exhaust from the sides of the boots shot off flames, Shinra would begin to move much faster. However, it was still not fast enough to catch Sho, Shinra referring to it as a game of tag. Time and time again, Sho would stop time and restart it on his command, Shinra always going to attack where Sho was instead of where he is, easily being averted and beaten time and time again. Shinra would try to take in all of the information that he had been given, remembering the past when forced Adola links had taken place. Sho had remarked that it was through this Adola link, by taking some of that grace from the Evangelist, that he was able to use this power. So, if forcing the Adola link tapped into that power, then maybe if Shinra could do the same, it could give him the edge he needed. The emotions that he was forced to feel from the links of those that had been formed with him, he would have to form those links himself. As he connected with Sho, he would push the memories of their family with the two of them together with their mother, forcing Sho to see these very images. As he did so, Shinra's suit would begin to glow bright red, his whole body being surrounded by flame. As Shinra forced the Adola link, he was blessed with a grace of sorts, but it wasn't just from Adola. While Shinra did form an Adola link with his brother, attempting to take grace from him, his body was blessed with a different power, a different sort of grace. The Morphin Grid is something of which we know nothing of. It is a power unlike any other, a power that rises to counter the evil of the universe. But for Shinra, unknowingly, from the link that was formed with his brother, and from the bond he had with his morphing, Shinra's body pulled on two powers from two different worlds, a power of good and a power of evil, the Morphin Grid and the hell known as Adola. As Sho attempted to freeze time once more, he would soon realize that Shinra was still moving within his domain. Sho wondered how he was able to do so, if he had stolen some of his grace. But it was more than that. Shinra's body was blessed with a different grace. It was the grace of the Morphin Grid itself. As the red Lightspeed Ranger would blur, moving faster than the speed of light itself, and Sho attempting to match him, Lit would realize what Shinra was doing. He was disintegrating and reassembling his body, moving past the speed of light at hyperspeed. As Shinra continued to move on with his brother, the two of them continuing in their fight, Sho would have the ability to stop time, but Shinra, he simply moved faster than time itself. Two frighteningly similar abilities, the true mark of their bloodline and their family. Hame and Mirage, two members of the White Clad, would watch from a distance as well as with Lit, as they all noticed the fight taking place. The girl, who wore a special like crown that covered her face, was born with a unique ability to mess with others' nerve systems via the electric spark that she could create, very effective against pyrokinetics. She watched on in marvel as the two Adola bursts continued their fight. Shinra, drawing on the power of the grace of the Morphin Grid, and Sho, drawing on the power of the grace of Adola, the light and the dark, moving in synchronization. As they continued onward, Lit would warn Shinra, as Shinra was starting to slow down, the damage to his suit proof of their battle, cuts and burns all over, his visor having been cracked to the point that his eyes could be seen. But Sho was not getting off either, as he too was battered and bruised, and he too was bleeding. The two brothers shedding one another's blood. Both Sho and Shinra would go in for another strike. However, as they did so, they would both find themselves in a void, and they would see shared images, memories of their past, all of their emotions coming to light. Even for Sho, for reasons he could not understand, he was being moved to tears. Shinra explained to his brother that even if he couldn't remember, he had made the promise to their mother that he was going to protect him and keep him safe. As such, he would always come running to him, no matter what. As Shinra went in to hug his brother, as they returned back to their normal reality, from out of nowhere, Shinra would feel a blade in his chest. It was the work of Hame, as she appeared happy and jovial, walking about. She revealed that things were getting out of hand, and that it was time for them to make their move, preparing to take Shinra with them back with the White Clad. However, before she could do so, Sho would stop her, wanting to know the truth of what had happened 12 years ago. However, instead of answering, she merely knocked him out with her abilities, forcing the command for him to leave, as she went to go after Shinra next. Shinra asked what she had done, why she was doing this, and she explained to create another great cataclysm, to finish off what the great disaster didn't over 200 years ago. However, before she could get any closer, the blue light speed ranger would appear out of nowhere with his plasma blade. Arthur, moving to cover Shinra, telling him that if anyone was going to slay the Red Devil Ranger, then it would be him, the Blue Lightspeed Knight. Hame would be very angered at the fact that the one ability that counted hers, pure plasma, was wielded by the Blue Lightspeed Ranger, his power proving to be more than what even she was willing to deal with, as multiple earthquakes would start to appear. As the work of the White Clad, they would leave, but they vowed that they would meet again someday. As Shinra tried to hold on to consciousness, his suit having demorphed from all the damage that it took, his body overheating, using his power to its absolute limit, the team carefully evacuated the Nether as the ground continued to shake and move around them. Without hesitation, they would escort Shinra to the best medical facility they knew. It would be that of Company 6, that worked not only as a Fire Force company but as a hospital, where their captain, Captain Wong, an expert in healing those with her flame, especially for healing other pyrokinetics, would be sent to do work on Shinra and help heal him from the damage. Lisa would also be taken to the hospital as well, as Vulcan would help watch over her. But still, it would be easier said than done, as while there were many things that could be cured, brainwashing and trauma was something a lot more difficult to deal with. And for Lisa, it would be a long road to recovery. For Company 8, they had learned much, and their powers aided them well. But there were still so many things that they didn't know. There was still so much out there for them to discover. Their fight with the White Clad was far from over, and their battle in the Nether proved more than anything that they needed to get stronger. Strong enough to face what was coming. And everyone agreed to do so. As for Shinra, it would take him 3 days to recover from his wounds. As he slowly awoke in the hospital, his bed next to the window, he would feel himself being tired and hungry. The only thing on his mind was that of his brother, and how he wished he had saved him the first time around. But still, he was not fully discouraged, and he hoped that he would get another chance. As he got up, someone would enter into his room, a person he hadn't seen since his exchange event with Company 1. It was the company's captain, Captain Leonardo Burns. As he walked to Shinra, providing him a meal, he would tell him to meet him outside. And as he did so, he would confirm everything that Shinra suspected. That he was there 12 years ago, and that he had known what had happened to his brother. This would anger Shinra. The fact that the captain knew all this time and yet never told him. He demanded answers to know the truth of why he had held it from him from all this time. However, Captain Burns remarked that he had tried to keep Shinra out of this, and that for 12 years, Shinra had the chance to get stronger, and that if ending in the hospital was the result, then the truth wouldn't have mattered either way. However, Shinra remarked that he had gotten much stronger since then, although the captain felt that that was just luck. feeling the intensity burning within Shinra. The captain would stand to his feet as he held his hand towards him, telling him to show what he could do. Shinra looked to his wrist and to the morpher, but the captain would shake his head, telling him not to use that power. If he really wanted to show what he could do, to show how much he improved, then don't rely on that power. But instead, the captain offered for him to show what he could do on his own. As both of their flames began to ignite, Shinra understood what he meant. For as far as he had come, maybe he relied a little too much on that ranger power. And it was time to see what he could do on his own. As the soles of his feet would set aflame, Captain Burns and Shinra would get into a stance, as it was time to show what his 12 years of training had taught him, as the two of them would begin their battle. This concludes Fire Force Lightspeed Rescue, based on the Heroes of the Morphin Grid series, Part 1. As always, if you enjoyed today's video and everything else that we have on the channel, then please don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, share, and hit that bell for post notifications so you can stay up to date on everything that is Power Core Productions and Podcastings that has to come out now and in the future. Stay tuned for Monday as we are going to be continuing What If Deku Was Iron Man? My Hero Academia Armored Adventures Part 3. But anyway, that's going to do it for the end of today's video. I'm Javon Harrington with Power Core Productions and Podcastings. Signing off, and I'll see you next time.